Hello and welcome everyone. So today I'm going to discuss vision therapy, a basic approach. So basically today we'll be talking about what is vision therapy and how to start vision therapy on a very basic level where you don't require quite a big fancy instruments or quite a big setup, because any procedure can be started with a very basic approach. So today's topic will be more on to understanding what is vision therapy and how to approach it on a very basic term or without much of instruments. So let's start our session. So the objective for today's discussion or the video is, what is vision therapy, what is the need for vision therapy, and how basic objects can be used in vision therapy. So we are going to talk about all these three points. So vision therapy, when we say, it has some other names as well when you go into a detail. So it is also called as your behavioral therapy, vision training, visual therapy, eye training, orthoptic therapy. So when you go on to what is vision therapy, so when we say the term vision therapy, it is actually a therapy which basically implies on rehabilitation techniques. When we say the term rehabilitation, it is basically making whatever ability you have to make it a more enhanced or in a better way. Like for example, a patient who has an accommodation which is less, like for example accommodative insufficiency, you cannot just insert more of accommodation into his eyes. Okay, what you can do is, as per his muscle strength, whatever accommodation he has or left with, you can make it, or rather train him to use it in a more efficient way. What we do is, whatever ability a person has, we make it more efficient for him to work. Like for example, what generally happens, that many times you do have the ability, but because of overuse or excessive use, or rather the spasm, or rather the complete relaxation, you are unable to use that in that full amount. For example, in accommodative insufficiency, when we say the patient is unable to accommodate, though the muscular power and everything is there, but he requires a training. So what we do basically here is that we do a rehabilitation technique. Whatever amount he has lost or whatever he has presently, we make it more enhanced and give him that opportunity to use it. So it is a non-surgical treatment for strabismus and lazy eye. Now there have been many researches which has shown that it is quite effective in strabismus and in lazy eye treatment, because of its nature of binocular vision into your consideration. In vision therapy, what we do is we train both the eyes together. So here we are not patching one eye, here we are not obstructing visual field of one eye, rather both the eyes are simultaneously or one by one it is used alternatingly. Coming on to strabismus, now here many people think all the strabismus can be treated. So what we do here is only the sensory amount of strabismus, not the paralytic one. Now people many times ask that, can paralytic squint also be treated? Now in paralytic squint, the issue is there is a problem in the muscle and your nerve. So you cannot regenerate a nerve, you cannot regenerate a muscle. If there is a particular deficiency of sensation or a sensory aspect, like for example there is impulse which is coming but the eye doesn't have a fusional convergence or a divergence, you can treat that. But if a particular nerve is not working or a muscle is not working, you cannot actually help it. The third thing is, your eye exercises improve visual skills. Now there are many visual skills which we know, so there are some of the eye exercises which we do to increase those visual skills. Training the entire visual system. So when we say the entire visual system, it is not only about vision, it is about saccades, it is about pursuit, it is about hand-eye coordination and all other skills. So we train the entire visual system togetherly. So coming on to what is the need of your vision therapy. Now many people say that, when we say vision therapy, on what population do we apply? People take into consideration that only vision therapy is for amblyopia or lazy eye or strabismus or some other, but it is not entirely true, because vision therapy is helpful for any person who has a visual deficit in terms of your binocular vision Okay, so what happens here that what is the role of an optometrist? So basically we say that early detection of your non-strabismic binocular vision anomaly. Now here non-strabismic because I say there are convergence deficiency and all. So non-strabismic binocular vision anomaly is important because these deviation may decompensate without treatment and become strabismic, resulting in loss of stereopsis and development of suppression. So what happens that if early you catch a particular phoria or a deficiency very early, so you get to treat it with very rapid progress. Like for example, I caught a patient with convergent insufficiency at a very early stage. The patient had a symptom but he never could actually explain that what is happening, but I with my objective observations or with my particular test I found out that the patient is having a convergent insufficiency. So what I can do is I can start treatment onto that with the help of vision therapy, which will give him betterment and will not lead to a decompensated phoria. We all know as per the pathophysiology of tropias, any tropia initially starts with a phoria. When not treated properly, it becomes an intermittent, and when still not treated, it will finally become a constant tropia. So if you detect it quite early and treat it, there is no such progress of the particular tropia and the patient will have a better prognosis. So that's why early detection and treatment provides a better opportunity for academic success in school aging, school going age group. We all know generally the small child, or rather the age group between your 4 to 14, it is one of the most affected age group because of their lifestyle, which is most of your near work, your education, your phone, your computers and everything. So they are very prone to such kind of problem. And for example, if they get any such non-strabismic binocular vision anomaly, which is actually disrupting their normal day-to-day work, like for example, a child cannot read or write for more than half an hour because he is losing that amount of fusion, and later on he is not able to concentrate again, that is actually hampering his progress. So if early detection of such cases happens, that could lead to a better future academic for that particular child. Or even not about academic, it would be better for him that such condition will not deteriorate and become a intermittent or a tropia. So this was a study basically done by your Madeline D and Datta P. So there is so here we have a study which was the same I said earlier. What they got is that the prevalence of non-strabismic binocular vision. So what they did, that any patient who came with an astenopic symptom into the clinic, they did a complete orthoptic examination and they found out the amount of non-strabismic binocular vision anomaly. So what they found out, that among the people who were screened or rather tested in the age group of 31 to 40, it was least, somewhere around 50%. In 21 to 30 years of age, it was something around 62 to 63%. And in age group of 10 to 20, now as I said earlier, the age group where people go to school year and everything, there is as high as 70%. So if you see, every 7 out of 10 child who are coming to your clinic are rather with a what we say symptom of asthenopia can be having a amount of your non-strabismic binocular vision. It has a 70% chance. So it is always better to examine such patients and then proceed with further treatment. So there was again one study done by your Husainuddin Jamila and others. So it basically saw the prevalence of the non-strabismic binocular vision anomaly into your school going children. So what they found out was the prevalence of your non-strabismic anomalies of binocular vision was found to be higher in the age group of 13 to 17, which was something around 36%. So this is the general population. So if we screen at least 10 students, which are general population, we can find around every 3 or 4 patient among them having a non-strabismic binocular vision anomaly, compared to the 7 to 12 years where it is 25%. Like every 20 patient, you will find around 5 patient being non-strabismic binocular vision anomaly. So what they found out, that highly prevalent among the school children and prevalence increases with age. So as the child progresses, there is more of stress onto the visual system, and any such symptom exaggerates as they progress with their age. So with increasing near visual demand in higher grades, these anomalies could significantly impact the reading efficiency. So simple, if a patient has a convergence insufficiency or a divergence axis or whatever, so that will actually hamper the child's reading ability or writing ability, which in terms will finally give him a rather effect onto the results, end results. So this is just a demonstration to show how actually a patient with non-strabismic binocular vision anomaly sees. So if you see this, all letters are written in 20x30. But if you see the first line, it is rather what is clear. A child sees that like this can pass a vision screening. But also a child with all the rest four can also pass your vision screening. So many times only vision screening is not a good criteria to say everything is normal. When we say vision, vision is only a part of your visual system. There are many other aspects which also help. So if you see, second one is where the patient is having a ghost imaging. There is again swimming effect of the your particular lines. Again, there is dyslexia. So generally what happens that after 20 minutes of work, the child generally sees this kind of things. So just imagine someone gives you a book to read for 2 hours and you are having such kind of problem. Would it be possible? Would it be very possible for you to read or rather understand things? So that is what we generally see into your patients. So this is again a very good example where patient is having a diplopia because of sudden deviation which is being manifested after a particular time. So this is a very good elaboration. Generally we say that around 80% of the learning is visual. Okay, so whatever you learn is 80% of the time visual, and if the visual signals are not proper because of diplopia or because of suppression or because of anything, so that could actually hamper your learning outcomes. And among 25% of the child have an undetected vision problem. So every 1 in 4 will have a undetected vision problem, and 20% of them actually have a reading problem which they never say, because many times as a parent what we feel that they are malingering, but many times they are actually saying truth, so that should be detected quite early. And the simplest thing is earlier the detection, better the outcome. So in such cases your normal school screening and all do help a lot. But even if a patient or a child is coming to your practice where he is having such complaints, not only about vision or refraction, also please look into other factors such as accommodation, convergence and rest, because that may be very helpful to actually have a diagnosis proper. Coming on to the next thing, successful vision training depends on what? So whenever we say such, an accurate diagnosis of the patient of visual problem. So let's say that if I am a good in your diagnostics, then only I can treat. That is a very simple and basic rule into our field. If you don't know the problem, you cannot treat it properly. If you know it partially, you will treat it partially. So an accurate diagnosis, if a patient is having an accommodative insufficiency plus convergent insufficiency, and you only diagnose that it is accommodative insufficiency and you are just giving the accommodative exercises, giving, the station still has a problem because you never saw onto the convergence part. So it is very important for you to establish a clear-cut diagnosis with many supporting tests. Like just looking onto your NPA, you cannot say it is an accommodative insufficiency. A complete battery of tests should be run to actually find many other signs that it is actually a particular problem. Second thing is a careful selection of the visual procedure to best remediate the problem. Now when we say this thing, people many times don't understand that for a particular person, everyone has their own choices. Like for example, I'm giving a dictionary to a 6-year-old child. He will not read it because he doesn't have any interest. Rather, if I ask that particular child to read a storybook, he will be quite efficiently doing it. Okay, I give rather a school book or something to a very old person, he will not like it. I give him something which is very quizzy or a book which he likes to read, that is rather which is helpful. Or rather giving a synaptophore to a child who doesn't understand, that will not help me. So choosing a procedure is rather one of the most important part whenever we do a particular therapy. And finally, a collection of the visual procedure that will facilitate the transfer of a learned visual skill into patient's own visual world. So whenever I am giving a therapy, I should be also looking into a particular aspect that whatever I am making that patient learn, is he able to transfer into his normal environment? am I teaching him accommodation only on a heart chart and he's unable to do it on his book? So once you do a procedure, it should be also transferable into his normal environment. He should be able to do the same thing without such stimuli. It should be not that only that heart chart is leading to a particular accommodation and nothing else he's doing. Only the eccentric circle is helping him to converge and rest time he's unable to do it. So it should be very much understood that whatever you are teaching in terms of vision therapy is actually applied onto normal vision aspect where he's going in back into this normal field. So coming on to the next point, that is vision therapy can be used in treatment of what all? So it can be used in treatment of your strabismus and non-strabismic binocular vision dysfunction. It can be used in amblyopia, accommodative dysfunctions, oculomotor dysfunctions, visual motor dysfunctions, and visual perception dysfunction. So this is a picture which actually gives us an idea that how vision and learning are correlated and what are the amount or what are the actual criteria which are required whenever there is vision and learning. So if you see among this, only 1/6 of it is your eyesight. So not only your eyesight but visual attention, that how good can you sustain your concentration during the task. So if I'm unable to concentrate for a longer time, there is no point. Every now and then I'm breaking my concentration, so that is not helping me to understand things. Eye focusing, how clearly can I see at distance and near. So for example, you are into a presentation where there is a presentation lying around 20 feet far from you. At times you look at the presentation, it takes quite a long to get it clear by the time the slide is changed. By the time you start writing into your book, it is not very clear. It is taking time. So it is actually hampering the amount of learning which you are doing. So eye teaming, again eye teaming, why we say that, can both the eyes work together comfortably to achieve a single vision. Many times you have that but it is quite latent. Many times it takes a big amount of time to single an image, so that is again not very helpful for you. And what is the visual perception? Can I identify, organize and interpret it what I see? Like for example, there is a complex image in front of me. There are a lot of objects, there is a lot of thing written. Can I correlate what is the object and what are the written material? Or how good is my visual perception? How good can I organize and interpret it things? So that is again a very important aspect in learning. Do you have a good control over your fine eye movement? Again, saccades and pursuit. For example, I don't have a good amount of pursuit. When I'm reading a particular thing at a distance board, I am unable to follow those properly, and every now and then I'm breaking my pursuit. So that is again going to give me lot of problem. I'm again having issues of tracing a particular. Every now and then, what is happening is that I am unable to trace a particular letter. So that is where these all things come into play. And vision therapy, what it does, it actually sees all this aspect together, not only eyesight but also visual attention, eye focusing, teaming, perception, eye trace, your eye tracking. So these all are taken into play your together into vision therapy. So next thing what we say is visual skills which can be developed with your vision therapy procedure. You can work on to crowding phenomenon, you can work on to tracking, your fixation, focus, that is your accommodation, depth perception, the stereopsis and all, peripheral vision. Now many times in many of these sports we require a better peripheral vision. So in dynamic sports it is quite an important factor that how good peripheral vision you have. Binocularity, how good your binocular vision can work, and it also improve the hand-eye or eye-body coordination, which is basically required in each and every aspect of our life. Like for example, you are typing but you are not good with your eye-hand coordination. Every time you need to trace a particular letter, then you need to click, your eye-hand coordination is not that good. Okay, or your eye-body coordination, you are unable to judge the steps, where to keep the footstep and all. So these are all aspects which are very much improved, and improves your saccades and pursuit. Basically what happens that your saccades and pursuit which are required on a daily basis, we improve that also with the vision therapy procedure. So what instruments can be used? As I said in the start of your video, that we will be looking basically onto very basic objects which we already have with us. So the first thing which we say is lenses. Now lenses are very commonly with us, our trial set is full of it. Prisms. Now here I'm talking about the prism bar and the loose prisms. Loose prisms are present into our trial set. Again, we have it from half a prism diopter up to 12 prism diopter, so that can be used. Then you have your filters, which are your red green filters or anaglyphs. Then occlusion, partial occlusion or a complete occlusion. We have flippers. Now flipper, either we can have a proper flipper with a particular lens, or we have some procedures also which we can use to make a trial set itself a flipper, where you just insert and remove the lenses. Other materials, now when we say this, any material which you find with a particular concept can be made into a vision therapy instrument. There is no hard and fast rule, though there are some standard equipments available, but at times some basic things like a book, like a drawing color book, or rather what we say, a toy or anything, can be made into a vision therapy device. Okay. So starting with binocular therapy, so generally in binocular therapies what we do is anti-suppression exercises and Vergence exercises. Your physiological diplopia, now physiological diplopia basically means the ability which we have, that physiological diplopia, that whenever you look at a particular point, anything beyond and in front of the horopter will be diplopia, will be having a double image. So basically at that point, this is basically used in your Rock string, so and regular follow-up. Whenever you do any such therapy, a regular follow-up is very much required, because many times if you break the particular follow-up, then whatever progress you had, that can again go back. So vision therapy exercises, it could be a coloring of vowels in the book and magazines. Now it is a very simple and basic things. You put an anaglyph to the patient, you ask him to rather mark one with red, one with green, or rather have a bar reader onto the magazine, put a anaglyph and ask him to read the complete lines or coloring them. So here what we do is we ask the patient to find a particular vowel, that is A, E, I, O, U. So what he is doing, he is continuously focusing, tracking and tracing. Three things are done simultaneously. Connecting of dots to a dot pattern. Now again, this is a very simple thing. So here again, the patient uses your tracking, tracing and focusing, tracing and drawing, picking up the grains and putting it in bottle. So here it is an high hand coordination, and also your focusing, swinging the ball training. Many times what happens, there is a video ahead which I'll show you how it is. So that helps in your Vergences, saccades and pursuit. Connecting small objects, fixing objects on the wall, walking on a broad line. And walking on a broad line is basically about your eye-body coordination. So here are loose lenses. So we all have this loose lenses into our trial set. So if you see, there are plus lenses, there are minus lenses. So what happens whenever we have a patient with an accommodative problem, that could be insufficiency or excess, we can use this lenses with the heart chart to actually give a response or a stimuli to get a response from the patient to accommodate or your to relax the accommodation. What we ask the patient is, we have a heart chart at distance and at near. So every time the patient had to read one line from your distance and one line from the near. So as the patient clears the image more and more, you simultaneously increase the power of the lens until unless you reach that particular value where he should be comfortable. Simultaneously, you should also give the patient your accommodative facility exercises, because not only the amplitude but also your facility is very important in such cases. Coming on to the next thing, that is your flippers, that is what is I'm talking about. This is your flipper which is used to increase the facility. So now, as it is a binocular procedure, and we all know that plus and minus lenses can also trigger your convergence and divergence. So these not only gives a facility of your accommodation, but at the same time they also make you to converge and diverge simultaneously. So this can be given as an exercise to facilitate the your dynamic response of your accommodation, as well as to give a dynamic response to your simultaneous convergence and divergence. The basic goal here is to improve your accommodative facility. Coming on to the next thing, which is pen push-up, I think everyone might be very familiar with it, but this is basically used to build a Vergence facility and stamina to train the accommodative skills. So here both accommodation and Vergence are simultaneously working, because whenever there is a particular target in front of you, very near to you, you not only converge but you also use your accommodation to keep it clear and single. So here both accommodation and convergence are simultaneously working. So here what we use is, it is a home therapy which is commonly given. We keep a pencil and we ask the patient to keep it single and take it near as much as he can. The moment it is double, again he needs to take it away, and then again he needs to take it nearer to him. What we are doing is, we are relaxing and again stimulating the convergence, that is basically giving an exercise to the medial rectus muscle and increasing the convergence demand or the facility. So it is given in the cases of your divergence excess, exotropia and exophoria. So basically we are increasing the amount of convergence here. Next is your Brock string and beads. One of the most common and simplest which we see, it is something which can be made even at home. You just need a rope or a wire properly and some beads. So what here we do is we give a particular points at which the patient needs to fixate. Here the biggest advantage what we have over the pen push-up is that we can actually have a feedback from the patient that is he suppressing or is he actually using both the eyes. Now how that is done? That is done basically with the help of your physiological diplopia. Okay, so also you can break the suppression here. Like in pen push-up, many times what happens, if a patient is having a suppression, he'll keep on telling you that it is single, single, single and single. But here, if the patient is telling single, he also needs to report you a physiological diplopic pattern. So if he's not doing that, that means it is a suppression present, and then again you can work on to anti-suppression and again onto your diplopia exercises. So it is used for fusional divergence and convergence both. So this video will give you a brief idea. So this is what happens when the patient is looking at the middle bead. He will see an X pattern, which is basically because of your what we say, the physiological diplopia. The near beads are again double and the distance bead are also double. So what happens now, again I'll ask the patient, once it is done, I'll ask to fixate on the other bead where he'll see another pattern. Let's see what he sees. Okay, so as the patient is looking at the far bead, he will see a particular A pattern, which we say. So here what happens, here it is single, rest all are double because of the horopter or the physiological diplopia. Always remember, keep a dark background behind your Brock string so as the patient can clearly focus or see your Brock string bead. And whenever he sees the near bead, what happens, that becomes single and the distance bead becomes double. So here the patient is not suppressing and he is very well doing with the convergence exercise. Now very common question which is asked, that how to keep the distance of the bead. Simply what I do is divide the complete rope into your three parts. Keep the far one as much as distance possible, intermediate at half the distance, and the near one is kept depending on the near point of convergence, rather slightly away from it, because I don't want the patient to straight away look at it and have a, rather what we say, a diplopia. Always start with what the patient can do easily. Keep it relaxing and then start stimulating slowly, slowly and slowly. In a case of convergence insufficiency, the patient is very well happy with distance. So he will say that the distance bead is quite easily single, the intermediate is single. But the moment he sees the near bead, it is problematic for him. So what I do is, I take the bead a further away such that it becomes single. Then I ask the patient to look at this, this and this. Then again go back to intermediate and then go again back here. This has to be followed for a particular 10 to 20 minutes. Okay, so as the days will progress, the convergence will better and you can increase your decrease the bead distance towards your nose. You can take it much more closer and see if the patient can now make it single. The end point of this particular therapy is that the patient needs to keep the follow of the eyes, that is basically divergence, intermediate and convergence, without the help of a rope, because every time he will be not getting a particular rope everywhere. He should be able to transfer this learned skill into his normal environment. Let's have a look at tranaglyphs. What is tranaglyph? Basically it is again your having your colored glasses. So red green glasses are used with a particular sheets which are again colored. So what happens, that we are creating a demand for fusion. What we do is, there is a disparity created. We keep these two a bit further away from each other, making a disparate image, and that leads to a particular demand for convergence or divergence from the patient to make it single and have a depth perception. So let's see how it is done. So here is a patient is wearing a red green glasses. So now here we are not doing the anaglyph and tranaglyph. What we are doing is, we are using the bar reader, which is your red green bars placed onto a book. So what will happen, that a patient will have to use both the eyes together to read the white one. The patient needs to use the green filter to read the red part, and vice versa. So if you see, With the green filter, only the red thing is visible, and with the red filter, only the green thing is visible. So what happens every time the patient is using both eyes, one eye, both eyes, one eye. So what we are asking the patient to do is both the eyes are working simultaneously. So this is what we generally do with the help of your Tranaglyphs. So next, one more exercise which we commonly do is with the child, because they are not ready very much to read, we are doing is we are giving them red green glasses. So now there is a set of your toys. So if you see, with the red filter, only whatever is red color toys that could be seen, okay, and with the green filter you can only see the blue toys, not the red one. So alternately they need to pick one red and one blue. Okay, so here what they are doing, they are using at a time one eye and the other time the other eye. Okay, so that is how this works. This can be very much modified. Even you can put some coins or like carom coins or red green coins and ask them to sort it out. Every time they need to pick one red, one green and one white. Simply that can be done. So next is your barrel card or three dot card, very commonly available, and it can be made at home also. Now that has to be very precise. So what we do is basically we divide both the eyes with the help of a septum. Okay, so the complete visual field is divided into two half with the help of a septum, and here the patient is asked to look at those two colored. Like for example, if you have this card, okay, you're asking the patient to converge, you start with the most divergent point. So what you ask is patient to look at this point. So what will happen? This eye will look at the red one, the other eye will look at the green part, and ask the patient to fuse it and make a single object. So he will say that it is a particular circle with half being red and half being green. That means the patient is fusing and he is able to converge at that point. After having a 10 second of particular hold at this point, ask him to change the fixation at this point, and after again 10 second, change the fixation to this point. So a patient with convergence insufficiency will have initial difficulty in this point. So ask them to keep on rotating with this and this and try to fixate on this if they can, but if not, they can again go back to this. If for divergence, what we do is we start from here and go this way. Okay, same as your barrel card. In barrel card, the patient will tell you that it is not a circle, rather it is a barrel which is half a green and half a red. So I'll give you a demonstration where the patient is doing that exercise. So here the examiner is demonstrating, or rather giving the instructions. So here it is divided into two septas with your right and left. So now the examiner tells to fixate on this point and keep it single and make it a barrel. So as the patient says it is a barrel with half a red and half a green, the patient will, your examiner will ask to hold it for 10 seconds, and once done, he will ask to fix it on the second point. And as that is done for 10 seconds, again she needs to look at the near point. So this is how you do this particular therapy. So let's say this lifesaver cards. So this is basically to train jump convergence or ability. So what I asked here is the patient needs to look at the pencil for what we say easy, to making it easy, because whenever you will converge with the help of that, you can actually make the other circle single. So just have a look how it is done. So because of the physiological diplopia, what will happen that the two will become single and you will see a single image which will be having a depth perception. So the patient needs to jump his vergences from this point to this and increase it in a particular level. So every time we ask the patient is that he needs to also clear the letters written at it and keep it for 5 seconds. The moment it is done, he needs to change the fixation and go above. Okay, so the next is eccentric circle, again very commonly seen. So these are the circles which we keep right in front of the patient and ask them to converge or diverge voluntarily to make these two as single. So now depending, now there is written A, B, B, A. Okay, so this position where B and B are kept closer or A and A are kept closer will depend on either your training for convergence or for divergence, because we know these are slightly eccentric circles. Okay, so what we ask the patient is to make them single. There's a video again here. So if you see, for convergence what we do is we keep the A and A together. Okay, so then we will ask the patient to focus at this pointer between the card, which will lead to a convergence. So the moment the patient will try converging, these two will give a false image onto your retina and make it a single image. Keep looking here, and then if you see, because of the false image, these two will combine and this will basically give you a 3D image. So then we need to ask the patient to make that particular thing as clear, okay, and ask to fuse it and make it a 3D or a depth perception image. So there should be, the larger circle should be floating closer to us and the other two should be down, and the patient has to clear the central target, that is basically an accommodative target, to keep it clear. As we know that accommodation and convergence both has to work together simultaneously. Finally, eye tracking. So what happens here, basically we are asking the patient to track a particular object onto different things. So it can be a vein saccadic fixator or a pegboard. These are commonly used. Okay, so let's give you another demonstration of a very basic object. So here there is a ball which is marked with some dots. So you ask the patient to look at those dots continuously. So now if you see, the moment I hang this ball and keep it this way, the patient is doing a pursuit here rather. Okay, now it is towards and away. So basically it is, your patient is looking your close and away, close and away, near and far. So that is very commonly done. Again, it can be done diagonal to give your different direction of gazes. So what is happening here, you are making the patient to train the pursuits and saccades here, eye tracking and tracing basically. So every direction the patient needs to perform for 30 seconds. So that is a very simple and a very basic thing which can be even done by the patient himself or herself. So they just need a ball and a particular rope, and that can be done very easy. So it improves, so to improve your eye hand and eye body coordination, what you can do is you can do simple task. Like for example, you can ask the patient to play with a particular, your table tennis ball, and take a particular bat and keep it doing for a particular time. So that will give him more of concentration and eye hand coordination. Also, you can ask the patient to walk in a particular line. If the patient is having a difficulty in eye body coordination, you can do this task where the patient can have a better eye body coordination. Or there are some other exercise like clap and tap. For example, there is a screen in front of you which has a random number of instruction, which could be clap and tap. For example, it says clap, you need to clap your hand onto the table with right or left. Now again, that will be giving an instruction right or left. And then there is tap, that you need to tap your foot onto the ground. So there will be again simultaneous instructions onto your TV or a particular screen where you need to continuously follow. So that gives you a very simple exercise to give an eye body or an eye heart coordination. So now this is again a very simple and a very basic thing, eye hand coordination. So what the instruction is given, that the patient needs to touch the right left hand with your red dot and the other side with the green dot whenever instructed. So whenever I say red, he needs to touch with the left hand. Whenever I say green, he needs to touch with the right hand. So this is what we are doing. We are continuously giving instructions. So if you see, he is doing it continuously, and now this is static. As the static phase goes, we will move into kinetic, that we will changing it. So now if you see, we are also changing the position so that he could trace, he could have a visual perception that where the object is lying and accordingly move. We are making it more and more complex. So here we are training the visual motor reaction time, how quickly you can see an object and how quickly you can respond. As the progress increases, you need to increase the reaction time simply by moving it very quickly or moving it into different directions. So these are some of the very basic exercises which can be done. So finally, I'm just talking now, this is not a basic thing. Now computer has come to us with a lot of advancement, so a child can work on various programs. Now we all know that the childs are not very much happy with this manual kind of your exercises. So many times games and all can be used. So there are many games into your phones as well, that is your Tetris block, which is with an anaglyph. So you can download that game and give an anaglyph to the patient and then ask him to play. So that will give him an MFPF exercises. So there are some of the exercises which are, I guess all of the exercises which again, so that is eye movement, eye coordination, stereo vision, anti-suppression. So here if you see, the patient is doing an eye-hand coordination. So every time he needs to pick a particular dot with his hand, using both right and left. So he's instructed a particular dot which he needs to find and do it. So finally, the take home message which I would rather say, that whenever you do an accurate diagnosis, that will only lead to a better results. Many times we don't see a very great result from a particular vision therapy is could be because of a faulty diagnosis, or rather a faulty procedure which was taken. Now when I say the term faulty, it doesn't mean that something to hurt anyone, but many times we don't figure out some of the key things while doing in particular diagnosis. Like skipping a particular procedure should be only done if you know very well about it and you know that it will not be helpful in this criteria. Okay, but I still prefer the complete battery of tests should be performed in each and every patient once you find there is any sign of a binocular vision anomaly. So doing a complete workup will give you a better idea that there is no other diagnosis which is present. Like many times, as I said, while diagnosing with accommodative insufficiency, we don't see the convergence part and we straight away start the therapy with accommodation and everything, and we are not actually looking onto it, and that is left untreated. Many times only convergence we see, that the convergence is not proper and we are not working onto the accommodation simultaneously. So these all points should be taken into account very well. Also, whenever we have suppression, that should be treated first, because until unless the suppression breaks, no other therapy would work. Because problem is, these are all binocular therapies, and in suppression, if there is present, this binocular therapy will not work. First try to break the suppression. Start with whatever you have. As I said, this complete video was basically on to how to start vision therapy on a very basic level. I had some examples where I showed that having lenses, having your anaglyph, prisms and everything, we can actually do therapies. It is something to start with, better than nothing. Simple, that start doing at least evaluations. Start doing evaluations with your patient. Just at least do your near point of accommodation, near point of convergence and all those, which hardly take a very much time. So that will give you more of your confidence to diagnose and start doing therapies for basic procedures like convergence insufficiency, accommodative insufficiency. And once you start doing it, proceed with further and further levels. don't straight away jump with very much high, because we also need to have a very good understanding how things are working. And also, it is not necessary that vision therapy will work same for everyone. It is simply also called as behavioral therapy, because each and every person will actually respond to his or her own abilities. And we also need to explore the small world of optometry, which will make a big difference as a practitioner. Many times we see that we all have our practice, but only thing which we are doing is rather contact lenses, that is also soft, and only refractions. We are not doing other things which are actually taught or which we already know. We should do it, because many times such things will make a big difference as a practitioner. Just imagine a patient who comes to you for only refraction, but you also make him aware that are some of the problems which are correlating with his symptoms. He will have a better understanding as you as a practitioner. He will develop a confidence on you that you actually found a problem which was not being told to him previously and gave him a proper treatment. So that is where it makes a big difference. So I would thank you all for a very patient listening to this complete video, and please subscribe our channel for further videos on vision therapy, optics and binocular vision. For any doubts regarding this particular video, put your comments into the comment section and I'll be giving your answers into that itself. Thank you and goodbye.